So I'm going to talk a little bit about Solar Pro Plus. To start, I just want to thank again Alan and Subodh for and Amaya and I'm not sure if he's out there or not, but for carrying this workshop so many years. I was thinking about it on the way the drive here today as I was sitting in traffic, and it's almost like whenever we do one of these things, it's like we're having another wedding. And so about 9 times or had 9 kids, I'm not sure which, but it's just how you put all this in place and it just sort of all happens. And again, it's really to the credit of the people that have carried it on since 2007, and Simone and Alan especially, to get to this where we are today. So I'm glad to see everybody, and we're going to start talking about Solar Pro.
Actually probably do.
You're here earlier, heard Mike talk about it a little bit. But it's to the sun, our mission to touch the sun, because we're literally going to be flying through the corona. It's going to be going closer to the sun than any mission has gone previously before. And the main, I'm not a scientist, don't ask me any science questions. We're overheating, we're going to study the particles shooting off of the sun, and we're going to study the magnetic fields and electric fields of the sun. One of the things about these pipelines is that they're going to go faster. Now, I mentioned that New Horizons was the fastest launch. It'll probably be the fastest spacecraft ever. It's actually going to go so fast that it would fly from Baltimore to Philadelphia in 1 second. I can't even kind of how fast it is. Just a little bit about the diagram, showing you a little bit how the here that many elements in the spacecraft is the thermal protection ring. That's really what protects us, obviously, from getting burned off. We get have the cooling system covers through and actually cools the little tips of these solar rays down here. Now, I like this. I think I do this with some exotic material that can be cooling this. It's actually just water flowing the tips of the solar rays and going back up to the radiator and getting all that. Four different instruments, one of which is shown here, which is a SWEEM instrument, which is going to compare particles, electrons, and helium ions coming off the sun. And then you have high antenna and then you do solar rays. This is another view. Another one of our instruments is the field antenna, which is going to take a look at the various magnetic and electric fields, the magnetometer and other parts of the field. The ice instrument is another instrument that's responsible for collecting various particles that will flow by the spacecraft. And then LISTER, which is going to take 3D images of the corona flying by. More information about what it looks like as we fly by. So it's shown here, but one of our key elements that we're going to be cleaning out anytime we have an opportunity, we might be in this nest with a lot of us getting closer and closer and closer to the sun. So our main collect phase, since we look at this from a slightly stronger perspective, is our approach here. So, I mean, it's almost like we're just many flybys in the trunk. You know, we're going to be doing one flyby of the planet, or we're doing many flybys in the trunk. The session period right here, 0.25 meters. Let's get close to the sun. Responsible for the prime, the higher atmosphere. And so they're on the prime, we'll switch over to the hot pair, we'll look at that, send the prime. If you have a prime, we'll look at the back pair, it's located right on the prime. Great communication to the rest of the spacecraft and the spacewire. From so the proper perspective, that you can pretty easy to know because it's one port out and it feeds in various other parts of the system. These are then a dueler will communicate either down to various instruments or to elements that are being produced. So this is our development environment. As I know, we have three processors. They're all Neon 3, FT, UT699E, either by what is now Cobham, used to be Aeroflex. Created out of Colorado Springs, but our primary software support is actually in Sweden. If anybody, any of you have used the Leon before, but I'm sure that if you have, you know the people out there in Sweden that get really good support in terms of the software part of it. We have a pair which is nice, 32 gigabytes of RAM. This is actually the most, pretty much the most that we've ever flown, at least on an APL mission. I know that there's other missions out there where they're flown quite a lot to have, but right now we have our 13 megabytes RAM to store memory in images and various other objects. And then we have the ability, like I said before, that FPGA that takes care of determining whether or not that particular image that's been booted looks good, it does a checksum, it verifies the operation. And then we have a nice big SSR to store all that data. Now, one thing I mentioned before is that each of these flybys of the sun, really not many opportunities to really balance the data during the period. So we have to get on after the and get all that down again and again and again and again. So the key element is to make sure that we have an SSR that's operational, so we're transferring data, and we record it from one SSR to the other SSR, so that we're always going to have at least two copies of that data on board at any given time. And again, it's all spacewire communication to the rest of the system. Come through little requirements. This first page here, the key one that I look at and say, oh, yeah, this is something new. This is something new that we're doing from an APL perspective that we haven't done before in our system. So like I said, and so I'm going to walk through these individually. Next slide, probably won't go through all of them individually because we pretty much see what typically see on a spacecraft. Again, three processors, we have to figure out how you're going to manage all of that, how you manage the code loads, how are you going to manage what's operating on the various processors at any given time. This is our first mission to use VPN uplink. I know that God has done it in other places at times, but this is the first time that we'll be doing that. Field experience that we had back on Messenger when we first started to use CFTP predominantly about playback data. And like I said, Flash, we had a big Flash SSR on Horizons, or a Flash SSR on New Horizons, but we didn't have a file system. We're dealing with the first time that we're going to have a file system where we're going to store data on our SSR with Flash. We also have the fact that there's some of this process that even at the rate that we normally do autonomy, if we have a our autonomy system wouldn't be able to operate as quickly as we needed to. We actually had some hard-coded autonomy aspects within the flight software, which again is very unique for the work that we did here. We also have in that information to make sure that we have that on side, that we feed it. All this, I can imagine, I can't even put in the words probably how much work we've gone to the anomaly situation of you know, the fact that one of these processes might reset. But that, like involved, you probably know, that seems to be where most of the work ends up being is looking at our beautiful design and figuring out how we're going to break it. And then finally, our spacewire transactions that communicate back to the rest of the system. As for this, you can read through, unusual there. We are having a GNC and CNDH on the same processor, similar to what a messenger and just typical flight software operations. So here's the detail. It's not okay, boost system. We're actually relying again on the work that Geisler did, as well as their MakeProm where that creates our image for us. They offer little hooks in there that you can sort of tag in there and do a little extra thing that we'd like to see when we do our booting. It's primarily the image that's created if you ever use the Geisler tools, similar to what you're already making with that. So that's one of the nice things about using that particular tool is that it's got a lot of boot expenses that we've seen in other missions. Typical CNDH operations, commands up, imagery down, SSR management, to do here is that we have this communication mechanism in place, I'll touch upon a little bit later, in order to be able to have GMP prime and ready to go. If we ever have that reset again, it's again one of our main focuses. So how do you deal with software on three processes? Again, first time at ATL, I know that other people have done it, but it's a very interesting issue that we work through in terms of how to handle that. So we have our hot spare, or our prime, a hot spare, and our backup spare. So what we really want to on and work through that, can we get to the point where we're just running all the same software and all the same messages, or all the same processors? One of the things we did to allow that to happen is just limit the actual interaction, the messages between what's happening on the various processors. So you can work through and have the same code running, but when you later talk about architecture, the CV architecture that we had gone through a lot yesterday, you don't know what's going on across the box. So the same code, I can load the same image on all the systems, and it just depends on who is actually getting the same messages in order to operate. So really a lot of the issues that we might have had if we tried to make a particular type of application for each of those processors, because any time they can switch, and we really have to have those ready to go. So the data they see here is we can't completely not having any data pass between the processors at this point. It has to be primed in some way. So 1 second, we'll begin to packet between the processors so that the GNC needs to be promoted from the hot sphere up into the prime. It'll be ready to go and primed and operational as quickly as possible. I think that's what the bottom bullet says there. So to talk sort of like a dumbed down version of the block diagram that you saw earlier, I would like to say that place the software in the middle is important. I place software operating on the three processors and the communication is primary all space wire. So we come in here, our skip of the skip card, off the skip card of various instruments and CNC sensors and actuators. We communicate through space wire to the transponder. We have one instrument that's off of the space wire directly, and that's the Whisper DPU, and you recall that the Whisper DPU is the Whisper element communicating through the DPU. It's the three sensor that we have, a little bit higher in data. At the bottom, we have another card that we communicate to, where it has more of the GNC elements that we need for operation. So this back in time a little bit before I go to the actual diagram that shows the flight software. We've been doing spacecraft for, like Mike said, for 50 years now, I think it's up to now. And we had a lot of, we have a lot of heritage. So we have actually on Solar Pro that you can actually see the code goes back to the 1990s with missions that we worked on before. We started moving along during the 1990s and 2000s working through various missions. It got to the point where we had three big ones, Messenger, New Horizons, and Serial. We ended up with a lot of code and this policy that we like to call modify last mission. And that's our group supervisor said, you know, we really could try to do a little more better reuse. And he was former, and being a Goddard, that he had seen the work that had been done with CFP and the corporate executive. He initiated an IRAD, internal research development within ATL, to see, can we take what is done with CFP and incorporate it into our software? And two computers here, that's the wrong button. And that was what we tried to do. Can we do it? Can we make it more modular? Is the way to make the software more reusable than just say, here's the code, do that. And we had a really, really, another former Goddard person, actually, a real sharp flight software guy named Mark Reed, who was the lead on the operation about storm probes. During that first phase A period, he took the work that we had done at IRAD and incorporated it into the RBFP, which then became the Van Allen probes. And we have to say, set the tone for the rest of our mission forward, certainly at least through Solar Probe. And the work that he did or just and his team did is paying off dramatically in terms of the work that we're doing and the reuse that we're seeing on Solar Probe Plus. And emphasize, I'm sure that you saw a lot about the work that's being done with CFP, and emphasize enough that community out there to allow us to reuse that code and take that code and give us such a big jump start was really beneficial and helpful in making sure that our missions are successful. So I'm looking forward to seeing that continue. Now through our stack of code, at the very moment we're going to be running the R10 operating system. This is the first time that we've used that. We have used R10 on the cube set that Mike mentioned before. share all the calls that are normally specific to these works, and you can make the same calls using our term. And the foreplay executive, as I mentioned before, as you saw yesterday, all the work is being done there. And the application. And I think we're on 20 now. And the coloring here is what we're looking for in terms of the amount of reuse. We have a fairly heavy amount of reuse for these core elements, commanding 23 economies, sign tags, you're kind of thinking expect to see to use. We're used here on the ICF manager. The ICF is the protocol that we use to communicate to the instrument, primarily because we re-architected a little bit of that with the multiple processor scenario that we have. And then you have applications that you would expect. CNC is going to be different every time. We have a new space wire, we have some new space for spacecraft interfaces. And we're doing things like ingesting files and uploading CNC. So that's the overall architecture. And then talk a little bit more here about the differences that we've seen. What was running on prompt. Now when we go to the hot sphere and backup sphere, we're not going to run much. We still want to do things like command, and we want to get commands in, and we want to manage our memory objects and those things. But we're not going to be doing time tags, we're not going to be doing economy, we're not going to be scoring, we're not going to be playback. From the perspective of the application, it doesn't know any difference. We're just getting messages, it feels like sermon messages. Doesn't care, what's not getting. And so it's just going to sit and wait until the point at which all of a sudden it becomes time, and then that data is going to start flowing in and be ready to go. A GNC will be produced in a reduced mode because it's just seeing those messages get ready to take over. And then we have some other hang around here where we have a little bit of CPP operations to get the files back and forth between the processors and things like that. So limited operations in terms of the output is not getting much telemetry. All right. I think that's pretty much it. I wanted to see if there are any questions. Okay.
Processes which aren't all up at the same time. How do you deal with a common mode, and how do you deal with transferring the state from one processor to the next processor that comes to a client?
Okay, so the second part is that we have a 1 hertz message that will be transferred from the processor to both the hot sphere and the backup sphere, and that's being done actually two different ways. We go through the router to get down to the spheres, and then we have a back end port that we also send it to the various other processors.
I was actually interested in if your prime has some state or data that is causing your mode failure, then you bring a hot sphere and it comes up in the same state and it fails. And then you try to bring up the cold sphere. I watch this. Common mode still works because you have a cascading effect. You can bring up the state. I was just wondering how you dealt with that or if you looked at that.
Well, we've hindered it. I mean, it's at the end of the day, from a state perspective, each of them doesn't have retained the actual
the
right, so there's that aspect of it. But I can see that if you had a fault in the flight software, and this is something we've considered, and we've sort of relied on the process, and we sort of having multiple applications on each of the processors that are different, have accepted that is what we do for standard operations. So if you have a problem. Well, one of the things that we do try to do in terms of making sure to say that if we do a new flight for update, the first thing is we send that up to the prime, to MRAM, get it ready to go. We reset the prime, then let it run to the back of the sphere for a little while. And does it look all right? And then if it looks all right, we promote it to the hot sphere. Does it look all right? And then we promote it to the prime. We leave those other applications on there. And so at least when we're post-launch, obviously we just reliably on our test to make sure we get to the point where we have a good operational software package.
And I imagine your time to effect, even if that didn't occur, you could certainly recover from where.
We do have state operations too, as well, where if we start rotation after rotation after rotation, we start to see some of the individual processes less critical. For instance, if we're the first time and we reset because the record's failing, well, we'll let it go through that initial reset because the record failed. But if it again the record failed, really care. It's not critical to us in this situation, so we just say, just don't even worry about recording that. So we have a few really full of actual applications that are so critical they have to operate, such as GNC, in order to keep the spacecraft operational, or spacecraft. tail out mode.
Thank you. Other questions?
So is the pulse requirement the same
as pulse element? It's a dual. The phrasing that they use it. Not single pulse collar. Single redundancy, getting dual and single mixed up. And then we do pretty strongly as we go through this whole process. We look at it and say, very complex system. And we have to get to the point at some point where you're saying, all right, this is single fault tolerant. The fault has already happened. If the next one happens, all bets are off. A lot of the design that we put into that, we've had a lot of discussions where people come up with complex sort of that one. And we have to, in order to at least stay within the box of development, make sure that we're at least single fault tolerant. And if we are, then and have all those other things happening at the same time. That's just it is.
So the way the computer's running, you have a prime, and then you said you have an external mechanism for the avionics event control.
That's right.
It's the one.
What happens there is that the prime will communicate back to the ARC, which is the avionics redundancy controller, and in there. These FPGAs called the mode controllers. And you'll feed back. Mode controllers will keep telling the system you're supposed to be a certain thing. And there's three of them, so they're triple voted. Like you're supposed to be a prime, you're supposed to be a prime. If it comes back and it doesn't hear from in a certain amount of time, it's a watchdog. What is a watchdog? It's the second watchdog that we have in the overall system. If it doesn't respond back saying, yes, I'm prime, then it will reset and then it'll be the hot sparrow that be promoted to prime.
So basically just a watchdog, a state of health watchdog on the prime to know that computer is still functioning properly.
Right. It's part, and then there's also a little bit of other parts where it actually deals with booting the software and things like that. The primary function with everything booted is exactly that, to make sure that we select the right one, and then once it's selected, that it's checking in to make sure that it really is the prime.
Right. Basically, you kind of waived malicious cellular nodes.
Right.
Responding,
or it's not. Right.
So it can't, for instance, it can't start generating bad data, send bad data to the other computers, and then create a
common problem. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it's just a from developers. Wow, that's a lot of fun. I mean, you have an FPGA over here that wants it to be something else, and you're trying to just initially get your first processor up there, and it keeps trying to tell you something that it's not. Very confusing. So we have, at least in our initial development phases, we had a little cheat code in there. That even if it came up, and even if it thought it was supposed to be, even if something was telling it the hot pair, we're not hot pair, but we're really the prime. So in development process, this kind of stuff, when you have these three processors and you're trying to get all the FPGAs up, we're all at the same time, it can be really a headache. So just a fair warning if anybody goes down that path again, a lot of thought on how you're going to actually do that part of the development, that part of the testing. Can be a bit of a headache.
Very good.
At a high level, about what kind of data you pass from the feedback to, say, like a hot spare and the
air. Yes, there's a. Yeah, I can. One of these slides here, real quick, and study. Mostly GNC data. So the GNC person. And the fault protection people got together to determine what they needed in order to maintain that type of data. And we can see that 1 hertz message that we have here really on pretty relying on the GNC leads in order to get money. And we limited that. That's some other part that some of the other programs or some of the other applications needed. And we really looked hard at what is truly the minimal amount that would allow us to get. And this is what we've got, at least for now.
So do you have like multiple copies of any of that data at all, or are you just assuming that as long as the PRC checks out on this data?
Yeah. So you get one in a second. We're doing it different ways, based on one of the paper and size, and at least we'll get there some other time.
Other requirement was single fault tolerance. Logic of why you have
two pairs. For the logic person next time that come up and explain it, they can at least go through what the logic of it from our standpoint. The single file array, in order to happen, that we really need the backup there in order to have that clean transition. Fine, by the time we have a reset on the prime, we need to go to. And we don't, oh, I can see why you're asking this question now. Right. So one of the fundamental foundations of this process, of this design is that we don't consider a reset a fault. So the fact that we reset it, that's not a fault. Well, it's somebody to go to. And if you have that other one, then a problem. So the single fault tolerance in terms of the three processes would be that third processor. It can fail. We're fine. So we can always have that second one to go to and reset from that. So yeah, it's still a foreign concept to me in some ways, even though I haven't worked on this for many years now, that we don't consider the fact that the reset occurs a problem, because we have to have resets because we're so close to something. It's just radiation environment is horrendous, and to even think that's not going to cause a reset a number of times is just not something that's realistic. Really designed into the system is the fact that we allow for resets. They're not there after that they're going to happen. It's not a big deal. Like a big deal sometimes, but we accept it. It's not really that big a deal, and we're just repeating along.
So, if
we're not
fault,
we need to get that GNC maintained as quickly as we can. So, in order to, we don't have to wait for the processor to reset and start up that GNC. We have to do it almost instantaneously.